Welcome to the Lync 2013 Ignite Lync Updates and Programs Lync Enterprise Voice Applications and Features Update course. I'm Brian Ricks.
And I'm Aaron Steele.
And Aaron, why don't you give us a little background on yourself?
So I'm a senior consultant with Microsoft. I've been with Microsoft for about 3 years, and during that time, focused specifically on Lync and Enterprise Voice. I've been doing computers and sort of overall Microsoft technologies and infrastructure for about the past 18 years. I started my real career in higher education and got my feet wet there. I live in Chicago with my wife and two wonderful children.
Great. And I'm Brian Ricks. I own my own private consulting firm, Brightcom Computers. We really focus on anything infrastructure, but of late, it has been a lot of exchange in Microsoft Lync. I am a Microsoft Lync MVP since 2006, been working with the product since LCS 2003 days actively. And recently, I achieved my Microsoft Certified Master's certification in Microsoft Lync. I focus, like I said, typically on enterprise applications from a deployment, configuration, planning, the whole end-to-game, end-to-end. Been doing it for 20 years or so, and been independent since 2009. Okay. For this course, the people attending should have a strong knowledge of Lync Server 2013 in the client to the point of deployment and utilization of it. This course is designed to be an overview of the new features that have been created since the RTM version came out, since release to manufacturing. There are a couple of courses that you can take on your own time to learn more about Microsoft Lync and get further in depth. 336 and 337 of those Microsoft courses can be used for gaining more knowledge and preparing for the exams, specifically for 7336 and 7337, which can allow you to get certified and work towards your Microsoft Lync MCSE.
Your communications MCSE, but then you got to do also Server 2012 exams to go with
you
that.
You do. It's a nice accumulation of specifics and the generalities. And then, of course, the CPLSs, the partners that give classes for you to go take structured courseware at, have these same courses to prep you for these exams as well. And you can use the link at the bottom to find a class near you. In this course, we are going to discuss four major topics. You'll notice most of these topics do not seem new and exciting since the release of 2013, so it really is just a quick overview of the features that were released at manufacturing for 2013. They include the response group application itself, the unassigned numbers, call park, and group call. Group call was new, added functionality post, so that's great. And then call forwarding and sim ring.
Specifically around the authorization of those features.
Exactly. So, call handling services, what are they? So a call handling service is something that interacts with a call inbound or outbound in some sort of fashion. Within Lync. So before you get it or before it reaches where it's going to when you're making the call. So there's the response groups. The response group service handles the calls like an ACD would, where it brings calls into a queue and finds an appropriate person or agent to route the queue to based off of Lync's presence information. Unassigned numbers, which is your kind of parking lot of all information. Parking lot, don't want to use probably too much, but it's a group of numbers that you own and the Lync system owns, and that's important too, because if you're in a configuration with a PBX and yourself, while you may own the phone numbers, Lync doesn't own the phone numbers, and if you put them there, you'll never reach them, right?
Right. It's interesting to see that this setup for the Lync unassigned number service can both be used for those numbers you own, but you can also use the same unassigned number service to control numbers you don't own that you may not want to have people calling or may in fact want to redirect numbers that are coming inbound via your trunks to other numbers outside of your company with this same system.
Yeah, in fact, we were at, speaking of, well, we'll get to that one, but unassigned and 900 numbers. So anyway, call park, having the ability to take a call and place it on a parking lot or somewhere that you can retrieve it with a pattern at a different location, a different endpoint.
Sure.
It doesn't have to be your endpoint. It can be any endpoint and the configuration that happens there.
Yeah, it's fairly different from putting a call on hold. This is more an orbit range, as some systems would call it.
And then group call pickup is the idea that a call is ringing for a specific group of users for one of those users, and anyone in that group can then retrieve the call with a particular number pattern. So with that, what is the response group service? It is basic ACD functionality. So the framework exists, and be clear, the framework exists within Microsoft Lync to do any kind of ACD functionality you want, but what is out of the box and given is a very basic, which is designed to be small teams. I see it for human resources, small groups like IT information services, the receptionist. We just did one recently that there were multiple receptionists in different cities that could back each other up so that if a call came into the main location and it was either before, after hours, or unavailable for whatever reason, after an X amount of time, it would then ring the Chicago office, who has nothing to do per se with their primary location, but they were able to route a call just like she could, so why not let her answer the call? And then if they didn't answer it, again, we can bounce it all over the world if needed to allow somebody to answer that call. So we can do departmental type or even receptionist-based stuff that way. We can do queues and routings and treatments based off of what interaction you want the people to have. So there's interactive IVRs. There's also just hunk groups. Basically, call comes in, it blasts out to whomever you want to go to within that hunk group. Kind of like a team call, but controlled from the server perspective and a unique DID, not one of the user DIDs.
Mm-hmm.
Very flexible in the types of ways we route calls. We have the option, the attendant mode, which I have a bunch of colorful words I use for it, but typically call it the forget presence mode. It just ignores presence and just routes the call regardless to everybody. It's kind of a blast kind of call. You have the ability to do serial parallel, longest available, so that you were getting the person who theoretically took the last,
amount of work.
In theory, right? But again, they're all presence-based, so we have the ability to override that manually if you don't have users knowing what they're doing. If somebody sets themselves to away, they're away and they're not going to get a call.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And this is a sort of especially important as you're deploying and you have Lync phone addition systems that could be these endpoints for these calls to be aware of this. Those phones will go into an away mode more regularly than the clients would.
Yep, and in fact, that's where attendant comes a great play. We had a good example of that. We had a deployment where we were using response groups for a mail room. And the mail room had a wall phone. But it also had the manager of the group and somebody else. They were all three or four were in this hunk group. But the mailroom never rang because it was always away because nobody was using that phone. So putting it to attendant mode was able to just blast it and let it go anywhere. And then kind of just route increase your escalations to bring the others after the fact. You can be very creative with the response groups. When you think you can't do something, you probably can. As long as you think about it. You may not be able to do it.
In exactly the way you sort of looked at it the first time.
Right, but the end result will be the same. It's just going to flow interestingly, jump queues and do things differently and may go into exchange and come back, who knows. But there's a lot of different options. And then we have role-based administration that was added back in 2013 so that people can have the rights to go in and manage their groups and their queues and their workflows, being able to modify it specifically to the ones that are assigned to those users. And it can be multiple users. They just have to be the same multiple users. And we'll get a little bit more into that, into how that works and doesn't work. But it is not, the stress is it's not intended to be a context center replacement. While all the data that you're probably looking for is present in the SQL database backend, it's not exposed anywhere natively in any of the GUIs or in the reporting services. Doesn't mean it can't be added on. Doesn't mean you couldn't custom create something. And there definitely is no limitation for you opening up the API and building your own. But it's just, it's very simplistic out of the box.
Most definitely. And it should be noted that we don't support database dips, programmability, skills matching type stuff in the routing engine itself. So you can't have an active monitor of the queue in that database as the things are going on. And we also don't support some things that context center functionality really depends on, listen in and whisper functionalities.
Recordings.
Right, there's a whole slew of context center sort of specific functionality that Lync doesn't provide. But with that being said, it does provide a really good set of features for those basic context centers.
And for free, which is
in the product.
Yeah, just natively part of the product. So if the guidance would be, if try it, there's no reason not to, see if this works and meets your needs. And maybe it meets partially your needs. Maybe you don't need to roll out a big contact center for everybody, but just a support desk that has 20 people that need to be monitored and managed in their queues. But for those others, this may be a great solution. So worth looking at regardless. So the architecture that comes around response group. When building a response group, you need to think about a couple things. One, there's a license involved from a CAL perspective because it's an enterprise voice. There is no way to use a response group without having a EV of some
right.
sort.
You right? can't be an agent in a response group unless you are enterprise voice enabled.
Right. So you're going to have the enterprise voice, and you're going to be Lync plus CAL, which means you're also going to have the basic, which means you're a full-fledged licensed person once you're going to be in a response group. The server is like a back-to-back agent where it's going to be it's bringing in all the communication and tying everybody's lines together and making all of this nice communication happening. The good side is that it's all in one place. The bad side is it's all in one place. So the bigger the pool, obviously, the more we can support. And basic numbers, as we're looking at an 8-server front end, is 16 calls per second. Now, I would argue if you're having more than 16 calls per second, then more than likely the response group service isn't what you're going to be wanting to need anyway. You need something bigger and more functioning, but a standard edition can handle two. So even for small businesses that are getting the random onesie, twosie calls, three or four an hour type of thing, a perfect fit for what mm-hmm. this is. It gives you the ability to have 15 departments and all ring to the same person, but it looks like something big and expensive and nice and fun. So that if that's what you want and that's what you need, you have that capability. You will notice that the active agents and the number of hunk groups doesn't fluctuate based off the sizing. There's an architectural limit to what the response groups can do. So the number of hunk groups, we're still sitting around 400. We don't allow us to say choose one for blank, two for blank, and put in voice. It takes a load off and we can almost double, if not double, the number. But the active agents, whether they're formally or informally, if they could be enabled to be in a queue, you're sitting around 1,200. Poor pool. Now, we can have dedicated pools. We can scale this in all sorts of manners and ways. But again, I would caution or argue that if you're going to be going much more beyond what a standard enterprise pool could do, you probably want to look at an alternate solution or something to add on to this.
Yep. And there are ways to integrate sort of other solutions in this from a call recording, call monitoring, call flow perspective, and still let Lync handle a lot of the media in this. So it's not all or nothing as well.
Right. Okay, so how do the response groups build? What are the pieces of this? Now, the key is to always remember work right to left in the GUI, because it's just the way it works. You're going to start with your agents. Agents are your people. They're SIP-enabled people. If you're doing it through the GUI and you haven't enabled somebody via a PSTN number, which you can now do with a PowerShell command to be an agent, then it's going to be an actual SIP EV-enabled person. They won't even be available on the list if they're not Enterprise Voice enabled. Those agents are added to groups. That's not the way it goes. To groups. There we go. Once we go into groups, the groups have definitions and associations with them that are specific to how calls are handled when they're coming into these users. So this will be, are they round robin? Are they attendant mode? How long do we ring these particular users? And so it's very plausible that you would have multiple groups with the same users in them, but with different settings, because maybe one group is the exact same users, but back up another group. You need to make a different group if you want those settings to be different. So if you want them to be formal, for instance, in one group and informal in another, then they could be the same list, same configuration, but that would be the only separation. With those, the groups go into queues. Now, within the queue dictates kind of what happens and in what order. So the queue indicates what group order we're running in, and then if there's a timeout, what the timeout is. And then beyond that, after the timeout, what happens to the call? Do we just disconnect it? A very cruel but possible option. You also have the ability to bring it right back into the same queue. You can loop things. You could go out to voicemail. You could go to an offsite number, whatever you wanted to do. It's got to go somewhere, or disconnect. Now, response groups are interesting in they're the only endpoint within Lync that can theoretically ring indefinitely. You could put no timeout on these things, and someone could sit in queue forever. Now, is it really ringing? Not if there's no phone logged in anywhere.
But they are signed in, or but the person who called into that response group is hearing music on hold.
Music on hold, yeah, forever. Which, good or bad, that's an option. But in response groups, again, is the only thing. Lync endpoints have a definitive timeout that you can increase them before they do something. Response groups don't. So if you want to just put somebody in a queue that you never want to answer, that is an option. Those queues are then assigned to workflows. Now, workflows dictate, is it either a hunt group or an IVR? And then goes from the IVR and hunt group concept to kind of what's defined in it. So all of that is built on this foundation that then becomes what we call the response group service architecture. So when we look at that, we look again deeper into the workflow defines what happens when a call comes in, what's the logic during time of business hours, if it's not business hours, what do we do, if it's a holiday set, what do we do, are there managers of this group, music on hold and things of that nature. Now a hunt group, if you don't play a welcome message on a hunt group and it rings directly in, you're just going to hear music on hold, immediately answering music on hold. One trick caveat you may want to consider is either record or find a public domain WAV file or MP3 that's a ringtone.
Ring back with pause.
And put that in. And then when it answers that hunt group, it sounds like it's ringing something. And you don't just go to hold music. Yeah. It sounds funny.
It's it can be a little disconcerting when you deploy that because you'll hear one ring as you're calling the number. You'll hear a second ring as you go into hold. And you may hear a third ring as the agent picks up.
Mm. Yeah, so there's ways, again, and back to our previous comments, where there's ways to massage the response group to do exactly what you want it to do most of the time with limitations, but it's just being creative sometimes to think outside the box. So yes, it's hold music, but why can't the whole music be a ringtone? Yeah, so you can do whatever you want it to do in that sense. There is speech recognitions and things to do, and you can go, one of the options would be to ring to an announcement service is in theory something you could go to, and so they could ring in, and one of the endpoints exits out eventually as playing an announcement, and kind of just dumping you.
Yeah, the interaction and building those interactions between Lync and Exchange's UM and auto attendant features is a pretty powerful way to sort of get some flexibility out of this service.
As we mentioned, queues, hold the calls, and the queue, which is what you would consider a queue to be, right? Something that it's the queue, a line, if you're European or British, right?
Queuing
queue.
Up. Yes.
So you're queuing calls up, and that's where people sit. And that defines what happens, like we mentioned, and then the agent groups themselves are where the agents are defined and their configuration. So when you're planning a response group, start with diagramming out what you think you want it to do. That may be what it does today if you're moving off an existing ACD or solution that exists. It could also be moving it to a place where you say, hey, let's go ahead and in phase two, let's go ahead and bring this to a point where we have enterprise voice up and now we have three people that are in human resources and we would love to be able to ring all three with a single human resource number rather than being people calling them directly. We have agent anonymity options. We have all kinds of cool callback features that you can do with anonymity when you use response groups that you would not have otherwise. And so there may be reasons to use the response group versus others, and maybe not. But it's phase two of the project is a great place to say, okay, things are working. We have enterprise voice. We have PST and dial-in capabilities. Now let's go and play with some response groups. And remember, response groups, while they are EV objects, don't have to be able to be DID'd objects. If there's no reason that anybody from the outside would ever ring into this number, and or you don't want anyone from the outside to ever ring into this number, perfect. Don't give it a real DID. They can't reach it externally. And internally, people wouldn't know it exists. So a great example is the receptionist queue. The receptionist number was a number. We assigned that to the response group. It then rings into the queue of users and the numbers as we're routing back to Exchange and back and forth as things are going to just fake DIDs internally.
Fake numbers.
That people are logging into. You also have the option, just as for those that don't know, you can enterprise voice enable somebody and not give them a DID. That is an option. If you do that, you probably want an option on a trunk, at least for those users, to have an outbound override DID. Otherwise, you're going to have an unknown number coming outbound. But you don't have to assign numbers to individuals if you don't want them to have a reachable extinction, as it were. Okay? But look at it. It's fun to play with. There's 26 languages. You can have it text-to-speech and write things in English and have it try to do it in Spanish, and it doesn't work so well. You can write things in Spanish and try to have it, pronounce it in English. Again, it doesn't work so well. But once you match up the language written to the language that is presented, it all works really well. And then once you've got it into some sort of pilot, just validate it works. And typically, when I'm in these scenarios, it's looking at, okay, this is what we can do, here's how it works, and this is the cost of what it's going to take if you want something more. And pretty much, unless it is a business hard requirement, we're done. And the response groups work just fine. Okay. Now, the response group application does have the manager role. So a response group administrator can go in and modify the response group workflows. They can modify queues, groups, anything that has to do with that specific response group. They can't modify anything else. And only for the workflow that you specify, which allows you to give that granularity for if you have an HR workflow and you want HR managing their workflow, let them manage theirs. IT can manage theirs, but you don't, and the system administrator could, of course, of Lync can administer anything, but allows more end-user delegation of administration, which is great. Now, they don't even see the workflows of those that aren't there. So there's no risk in modifications or changes to anything. It's not on your honor system. it's more of a, we're delegating rights to you. There's some caveats that happen with this role, but the capabilities get to being able to add, move, put people in, put people out. I see this a lot when we have an on-call person that they want to change it weekly. Well, I don't want to manage that, but the manager can go in and change that out weekly if they want, do whatever they want from a call flow perspective. And they use what they already have. It's the web. They could use management shell if you wanted to give them remote management shell capabilities. Yep. But it's going to your Lync control panel, and they're going to see the response groups that they have rights to. And then from there, they can launch the workflow, which is the web page of the response group web configuration tool. Right? So very simple. There's no applications to deploy. Very easy to manage and navigate. Now, when it's a managed application and when you've decided that a workflow is actually managed, the management of it happens by whatever SIP URI you put into that field, or multiple SIP URIs as the case may be. Caveat is, once a response group is managed, you can no longer share groups and queues that are associated with that workflow. And the reason being, you don't want overlap. You don't want somebody getting into a workflow that isn't available, that is somebody else's. Now, if you create another workflow with the same manager, they're going to have the same ability to make modifications to the same things. Yeah, unmanaged, we can cross over, and that's shown better here, where we have manager one has workflow, and multiple queues, they're managed, it's all good and going. Manager 2 has a workflow in his queues. They can't cross talk to one another, but unmanaged could. A workflow in an unmanaged could use a queue and that's being used in another workflow. So.
Yeah, it's good to remember that when you're, this isn't a technological limitation as much as it is, you need to make sure you don't incorrectly configure this.
Right. Yeah, well, all we're doing is making it so two managers can't step on each other. We're doing it for you. You can thank us later. Okay. And that's response groups as a quick overview. Then we have unassigned numbers. Now remember, the unassigned number service is the ability for calls to come in, and if you own the call, to do something. Now, as I mentioned earlier, we did use this in a 900 service scenario, where when anybody dialed any
premium numbers.
Yeah, premium. Premium number service, where anybody called a number that was an at-cost number to the company, it would be intercepted by the unassigned numbers. Unpleasant message would be played, and then it would be immediately forwarded to the HR department, and they had a call coming in that showed that it was coming from a user on an unassigned number. So there are creative ways you can play with the service. The announcement service itself is a very powerful tool that can be used for way more than just unassigned numbers.
Yep.
It can play any message. It can do call a number after, go to a voicemail, do all kinds of things after timeouts. There's great ways to do things.
So. And it's everything from a DID range to a specific and unique number.
Phone number, right. And
single,
which
number
is good
range.
Or bad. Yeah. There are companies that have very disparate DID ranges that are broken up with blocks of 4, 10, 4, 6, 4, in a sequential number range. And in a perfect world, you're adding every single range exactly the numbers you own. Because if you were to add a number that you didn't own and somebody actually wanted to call that number from Lync, it would never get there. They would get the your unassigned number. But that's really a call of who's going to call what. Are you willing to take that risk from an ease of management? And if somebody does call and say, I can't get this number, you could break that one number out and then keep going. Well, you know, there's different ways, but that's the unassigned number. Block numbers, play announcements, send it to other people, send it to voicemail.
It should be noted that you can't apply this granularly. That is, it's a global setting per those numbers. That is, I can't make it so that Brian doesn't hit the unassigned number range, but I do hit the unassigned number range.
Right. So when we're looking at call flows, it is something we look at as an enterprise level. That means the entire Lync rollout. This is not site dependent. This is the entire Lync enterprise is owned by this. So, and that's the announcement service. You really need to make sure that you are covering all your numbers and entries are matched. Don't have to enter them top to bottom, but it makes management of your life much easier when you're looking for a number to break out.
Entry top to bottom isn't required, but order top to bottom is. You also want to make sure that you understand as those calls are flowing. What this means is you can have a range and then specific numbers within that range that do something different.
That's right. So you could have your whole company and then throw on top of it five of those numbers that do something different. We do look top to bottom when we're flowing. But if they all do the exact same thing, other than management of it, it's just what's going to only hit one location, then it's going to only hit one. Unique, the IDs have to be beginning to end, they have to be unique. So you can't have a greater number and then a lesser number. You need to be able to make sure it's all inclusive, and ideally it covers every Lync number that you could potentially have internally. Okay, and that is the announcement service and unassigned numbers. Now, call park and group call. When we look at call park and group call, we have some options for parking calls. So the orbit ranges are created and they are specific to a pool for the users on those pools who are parking the call. Now when I say that, I mean if you make an orbit on pool A and I am a member of pool A, I can use that orbit to retrieve a number or to set the number. If I set the number, any user on pool A, B, or C can retrieve it. However, if I am on pool C and I'm enabled for call park and I go to park that call, I don't have an orbit that's on pool C, I can't park the call. So you need to have it, you're only required to have an orbit per pool, but they need to be unique across the entire enterprise so that we don't have any overlap. They shouldn't be extensions of any sort. Star or asterisk are a great way to start it, but then it does require three-digit ranges. They can be long. I wouldn't make them too long if I were you because you've got to remember it and type them in. I have a preference of star. I've seen problems with asterisks when we have mixed interactions with other PBXs, but star always seems to be a great answer. So star 100 or star 199, for instance, would give you those 100 numbers that you could potentially park calls at. If you only need a single range, there's no reason to make it a super small range. But there's no reason to make it a massive range either. But still, I wouldn't limit yourself to 10 numbers just because you don't think you're going to need more than 10. Put in the 100 and just have 100. We're not impacting anything. They're not in use if you're not using them. So they're just database entry points. So that's call park. Nothing's changed since 2013 or 2010 for that matter. So group call pickup, again, is new in that it allows us to create a number specific to a user or a group of users, and then we can pick up a call when their phone rings and we want to retrieve it for them. So in a team scenario where we haven't set up team calling, when person A's phone rings, Lync user A, and you're Lync user B, you hear Lync A's phone ringing, you can type in a code and retrieve their call without going over to their desk. They'll get notified you picked up their call and everything goes off happy and go lucky. The process works. It is set up and configured using a separate Lync application server that would have to be added and configured to the organization. And then there's a tool, CIFAUTIL, that is used to configure this. And it's all documented on TechNet how to configure the group call pickup. But there is no PowerShell and or GUI creation process at this time for call pickup. More is being developed, though, and watch the blogs for additional stuff as things are coming out. So how do you plan this? Again, orbits need to be unique. Orbits should not be DIDs. If it normalizes, it's not going to hit the call park range. So there should never be a call park orbit in your dial plans, ever. Allocate them in a manner that makes it understandable. Again, typically one per pool. You can't create them per site or per logical regions. There's no way to dictate where, if you have the whole pool range available to you if you are in a particular site and there is a call park range in that site. So because of that, just keep it logical. Make it so it's something that makes sense. 2010 and beyond can park calls. So if you have a 2010 client, you have a 2013 client, you can go ahead and forward to parking lot. You also have the attendant console, which can do the same thing. Common area phones can get those calls back. PBX numbers can get those calls back, so assuming they can route to your system. Things that can't park calls are going to be common area phones. Analog phones. Analog phones cannot
PBX park calls. PBX can't.
What else can't? Mobile phones, if you're using the Lync client, can't still today, unfortunately, park a call.
Kind of makes sense.
So that's where we're at. So PBX phones, analog phones, mobile phones. But everybody else, we're good to go.
Whereas group call, it's a little different.
The group call is different in that you 2010 and beyond can park the call. Common area phones and PBX phones can still get them. From a group call perspective, 2010 and higher can pick up mobile analog PBX or own can't do any of the group calling stuff. So if you have an analog phone in a call park, you can retrieve a call. In a group call, you cannot.
Right, you can't
dial. Has to be a Lync person.
Right, you can't go to a PBX and dial the group call pickup number to pick up an extension
call.
For somebody else.
Because right, it's for routed else. Directly to a SIP URI that doesn't exist correctly and it doesn't work. So it's all configured, like I mentioned, through CFA UDL, which does require a separate Lync application server to be set up, whether temporarily or permanently. Something needs to be configured. You probably want to add something decent for future applications. It doesn't have to be dedicated to just this, but it is an application server doing something for you.
A trusted application right. In the environment where you run this binary targeted at, things like that.
Oh. Okay. And that's call park and group call pickup. Okay, call forwarding and simmering. Now this, again, like Aaron mentioned, is specifically targeted at authorization. So obviously we've had call forwarding and simultaneous ring for a long time. The difference here is that in 2013, we allowed it to say we were not forcing you to use your dialing properties and authorizations that you have as a normal phone outbound for your call forwarding and your simultaneous ring. So a good example is, while I am in the office, I do have the ability to forward my or to make calls to international numbers. I do not want myself to ever be able to forward my calls or simultaneously ring an international number. In 2010, there was one or the other. You either could or you couldn't, and it's just the way it was. In 2013, we break it up to say either use your dial plan. There's a nice default that says only let it ring internal extensions, which means it can't use any trunks, or a specific
authorization, specific route, effectively.
Right, that we've configured and set up. So it helps in avoiding you kind of scenarios where people would set their phone to call forward, go home, make a call to a loved one somewhere far, far away, and while their call was local and it didn't cost their loved ones anyone, or maybe there were people they didn't like. It really doesn't matter. The person they're calling, whoever it was they called, nobody received the charges but you as the company. And so this avoids that abuse of the system. And a big request. And it accidentally happens at times as well. So the voice policy is created here, and the voice policy usage of local is given to you as a user, and it includes internal customs, all kinds of stuff, but call forwarding is internal only, and that's where we can set in the GUI or PowerShell, of course, the specific policy that a voice policy has for call forwarding and simultaneous ring.
Yep.
Yeah. Very nice, and like I said, a big ask for a very long time. Well, long, since 2010, I guess not that long, but yeah. So to configure it, again, you can use Lync management shells. There you do a new call forwarding usage type and set its properties to the voice policy. And then you can enforce that on a per user, per site, or globally. You can change things from a user to not make any changes, and by default, it just uses whatever their current dialing properties are. And it can be done through the GUI of the control panel as well. And that's really a good overview of 2013 RTM features. So
voice applications in Lync 2013.
That's right. Now, don't forget that in February, there is a Lync conference, the Lync 2014 conference.
Yay!
Yes. Not the version of Lync 2014, but the year 2014 conference for Lync. There you go. And it's February 18th to the 20th in Las Vegas, Nevada. Looking forward to seeing everybody there. It should be a great time. 2013 was an amazing event, and I expect this one to be as well.
Most definitely. You can register
at linkconf.com, and the seats do fill up very quickly. So if you are planning or thinking of going, I would suggest registering as soon as possible.
Yep.
Okay, and thank you so much. We appreciate you attending.